On this day, which we call Good, the Church prayerfully contemplates the mystery of the cross. This is more than a day of mourning. It is a day of victory. On this, the saddest of days, the Church wants us to see the purpose and effect of the cross, the redemption and salvation of mankind. Life, not death, will have the last word. The apparent defeat is actually a victory to be completed at Easter. Mass is not celebrated today. The Good Friday liturgy moves through three distinct stages: the liturgy of the word, the veneration of the cross, and Holy Communion. We are about to celebrate the Lord's Passion.
Jesus, Lord, condemned, defiled, may we too be meek and mild as we tread your holy way. May we feel no bitter hatred when we too are persecuted, left alone to walk with you. Life eternal, death defiant, bowed his head, the world was silent. Through his death, life came anew.
O God, who by the passion of Christ your Son, our Lord, abolished the death inherited from ancient sin, by every succeeding generation, grant that just as, being conformed to him, we have borne by the law of nature the image of the man of earth, so by the sanctification of grace, we may bear the image of the man of heaven, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the sons of man. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless. For those who have not been told shall see. Those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, no appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity, one of those from whom people hide their faces, spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured. While we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way. But the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away. And who would have thought any more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people, a grave was assigned him among the wicked, and a burial place with evildoers, though he had done no wrong, nor spoken any falsehood. But the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty. Because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked, and he shall take away the sins of many, and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Father,
Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. Father, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. In you, Lord, I take refuge. Never let me be put to shame. In your justice, rescue me. Into your hands I commend my spirit. Lord, O faithful God, Father, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. But my trust is in you, O Lord. I say you are my God. In your hands is my destiny. Rescue me from the clutches of my enemies and my persecutors. Father, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. Let your face shine on your servant. Save me in your kindness. Take courage and be stout-hearted. All you who hope in the Lord. Father, I commend my spirit.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
to you, Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ. Glory to you, Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ. Christ became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name. Glory to you, Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ. Glory to you, Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kindron Valley to where there was a garden, to which he and his disciples entered. Judas, his betrayer, also knew the place because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas got bands of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees and went there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered him,
"Jesus the Nazarene."
He said to them,
"I am."
Judas, his betrayer, was also with them. When he had said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So he again asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
And they said,
"Jesus the Nazarene."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am. So if you're looking for me, leave these men alone."
This was to fulfill what he said to them, "I have not lost any of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword into its scabbard. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father gave me?"
So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guard seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Ananias first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Now, the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid, who was a gatekeeper, said to Peter,
"You are not one of this man's disciples, are you?"
He said,
"I am not."
Now the slaves of the guards were standing around a charcoal fire that they had made because it was cold and were warming themselves. Peter, also standing there, kept warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
"I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in a synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gathered. And in secret I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
"Is this the way you answer the high priest?"
And Jesus answered him,
"If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
And then Ananias sent him bound to Caiaphas the high priest. Now, Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him,
"You are not one of his disciples, are you?"
He denied it and said,
"I am not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said,
"Didn't I see you in the garden with him?"
Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning, and they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to defile so that they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
"What charge do you bring against this man?"
They answered and said to him,
"If he were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you."
At this, Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law."
The Jews answered him,
"We do not have the right to execute anyone."
In order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
And Jesus answered,
"Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?"
And Pilate answered,
"I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done?"
Jesus answered,
"My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here."
So Pilate said to him,
"Then you are a king."
And Jesus answered,
"You say that I am a king. For this I was born, for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice."
And Pilate said to him,
"What is truth?"
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
"I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?"
They cried out again,
"Not this one, but Barabbas."
But Barabbas was a revolutionary. And then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the soldiers wove a crown of thorn and placed it on his head. He clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came to him and said,
"Hail, King of the Jews."
And they struck him repeatedly. Once more, Pilate went out and said to them,
"Look, I am bringing him out to you so that you may know that I find no guilt in him."
So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak. And Pilate said to them,
"Behold the man."
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out,
"Crucify him! Crucify him!"
And Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him."
The Jews answered,
"We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God."
Now, when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid, and went back into the praetorium and said to Jesus,
"Where are you from?"
Jesus did not answer him. So Pilate said to him,
"Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you and I have power to crucify you?"
And Jesus answered him,
"You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin."
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
"If you release him, you are not a friend of Caesar. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar."
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in the place called Stone Pavement, in the Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon. And he said to the Jews,
"Behold your king."
And they cried out,
"Take him away, take him away, crucify him.
And Pilate said to them,
shall I crucify your king?
The chief priests answered,
we have no king but Caesar.
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, or in Hebrew, Golgotha. Then they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross, and it read, Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews. Now many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, in Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate,
do not write the King of the Jews, but that he said, I am the King of the Jews.
And Pilate answered,
what I have written, I have written.
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, and the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top down. So they said to one another,
let's not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it will be.
In order that the passage from Scripture might be fulfilled, that says, they divided my garments among them, and from my vesture they cast lots. This is what the soldiers did, standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother, and the mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciples there whom he loved, he said to his mother,
woman, behold your son.
And then he said to the disciple,
behold your mother.
And from that hour, the disciples took him into his home. After this, aware that everything was now fulfilled, in order that the scriptures might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
I thirst.
There was a vessel filled with common wine, so they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus took the wine, he said,
it is finished.
And bowing his head, he handed over the spirit. Now, since it was preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their leg be broken and that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and then of the other who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus, they saw that he was already dead. They did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness had testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you may also come to believe. For this happened so that the scriptures passage might be fulfilled. Not a bone of it will be broken. And again another passage says, they will look upon him whom they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he would remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and buried it with burial cloth along with the spices according to the Jewish burial custom. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. My brothers and sisters in the Lord, one of the most heart-wrenching cries of the crucified Jesus is not recorded in the Passion according to St. John that we just heard proclaimed, but it is in the Passion narratives according to St. Matthew and St. Mark. It is the first verse of Psalm 22. My God, why have you forsaken me? And my brothers and sisters, on this Good Friday, many of us may have those same words on our lips. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why have you abandoned me? What shocking words, my friends, from the dying lips of God's own Son. The cry of a soul feeling abandoned by his Father. A moment of bitter, utter desolation, terrifying for Jesus, terrifying for his mother, and for the disciples standing death watch at the foot of the cross. And terrifying for us, my friends, for this God-man is crucified for no other reason than the sins of the human race, your sins and mine. As we reflect on these words, my God, why have you forsaken me? Take a moment, my brothers and sisters, to imagine the worst. The worst that could possibly happen has already happened. Far beyond plague, or pandemic, or the coronavirus, or nuclear annihilation, or the withering of the last flower, it happened a certain Friday afternoon outside the walls of Jerusalem. There we turned on the one who embodied all the light, all the love, and all the hope that ever was and ever will be. That, my friends, is what we did to God. That is what we did to God. Because it is what we have done, and it is what we will do to one another, to ourselves, from Adam's sin to yours and mine. My friends, hear in Jesus' cry the agonies of humanity. Casualties of war, victims of oppression, hunger and natural disaster, the Holocaust millions, 9/11 thousands, abortions millions, the coronavirus's thousands, and so many more. Including all who have suffered the indignities and infidelities that are so sadly so much a part of the fabric of human experience and family life in our present culture. And God's own Son, in an act of radical, nearly incomprehensible love, takes all of that guilt upon himself to break forever sin's deadly power. He becomes sin, St. Paul declares, to save us from sin. For us, for all mankind, Christ takes the bullet. You see, my brothers and sisters, as we gather on this Good Friday, several truths stand out as we ponder the Calvary scene. First, my friends, the call to face and acknowledge our own sinfulness. But you see, my brothers and sisters, we live in a time, in a world, where sin is all but forgotten. Oh, we see the manifestations of sin every time we read a newspaper or watch the evening news or look at something on social media. We see the murders and the robberies and the rapes and this on and on and on. So many contemporary movies and even network TV shows portray infidelity and fornication as though they are expected and an accepted part of anyone's life experience. You know, my friends, I always worry about the effect such things have on the moral formation of our children, on our youth, on each and every one of us. It's easy, my friends, to see the sin in all of this and in all of that. It's easy to see other people's sin. Sometimes we simply just call it the sin of the world. But we do need to recognize, my brothers and sisters, our own personal sin. Our little infidelities, our moments of selfishness, our failure to pray and worship as fully and faithfully as we should. Our harsh words, judgments, even slander of others, our petty lies, our mean gossip, our failures to forgive. It is only as we accept responsibility for our own personal sin that we will be able to hear the Lord's invitation to each and every one of us, to conversion of heart, to repentance, and to receive his forgiveness. It is only then that we're able to taste his mercy. The 14th century English mystic Julian of Norwich said it the best when she said this. We need to fall, she wrote, and we need to realize this. If we never fall, we will never know how weak and wretched we are in ourselves, nor will we ever appreciate the astonishing love of our Maker. You see, my friend, Good Friday is about all of that. The second truth, Jesus' startling example of loving, faithful solidarity with mankind, with us, even in our sinfulness. His plunge into death for our sake summons us to be in solidarity with one another and most particularly with those who suffer in body and mind and spirit this day. Who suffer from injustice and violence, from disease and war. The hundreds that are in the hospital this day in our own metro area. Family members who are separated from their loved ones because they're not allowed in. Individuals who die alone because loved ones cannot be there. But to embrace this solidarity, my brothers and sisters, is to be willing to drink from the cup of suffering. Because you see, my friends, compassion is quite literally the act of suffering with another. Sharing the burden, lightening the load. Jesus loved to the very end, and so we are called to do the same. My brothers and sisters, on this Good Friday, do not waste your sufferings. Join them to those of Jesus on the cross. Suffering in itself, my friends, does not make us holy. It is only when we unite it out of love to the suffering of Christ that it has meaning. Suffering without love, my brothers and sisters, is wasted pain. But let us remember, all the misery of the world, past, present, and future, could never compare with the sufferings of Jesus. Whatever you're going through this day, whatever you're going through this moment, whatever your family and friends are going through right now, know that Jesus has been there first, and he did it out of love. Good Friday, my friends, is about all of that. Third, my brothers and sisters, Jesus' cry of forsakenness, as desperate as an expression, as evidence of abandonment as it sounds, it is not in the end a cry of profound despair. Why? Recall, my brothers and sisters, that Psalm 22, which Jesus here is quoting, while beginning with words of abandonment, builds to a crescendo of praise and thanks to God. Listen to the psalmist's underlying hope in the saving power of God. You who fear the Lord, praise him, for he has not despised nor discarded the poverty of the poor, has not turned away his face, but has listened to the cry for help. You see, my brothers and sisters, Jesus' cry is the prayer of a persecuted, innocent man, torn by affliction, yet trusting still in God, his Father, as his consolation and his hope. The bottom line, my brothers and sisters, absurd to many, but light for us who see with faith-filled eyes, is that suffering and death, in that is found our salvation. For Jesus and because of him, for us and the world, the cry of agony will give way to the resurrection hymn of thanks and praise. You see, my brothers and sisters, even if we are at that point of abandonment, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why have you abandoned me? Remember that it always crescendos into a hymn of praise, of thanks to God, for God works all things out for good for those who trust in his ways. Good Friday and the Easter soon to come is all about that. But today, my dear friends, we stand on Calvary with Jesus. We venerate the cross of our Lord. My friends, don't be afraid of the cross. The cross is the door to paradise. We need to meditate often on the sufferings and death of Jesus. Every Catholic home should have a crucifix in a prominent place. We should meditate often on the sorrowful mysteries of the rosary, read the accounts of Christ's passion from sacred scripture, and make the stations of the cross. A cruce salus, from the cross comes salvation. We should contemplate Jesus dying to make the full payment for our sins. We must respond to the love Jesus demonstrates for us on the cross by our willingness, my friends, to make sacrifices for his sake. Jesus calls us today, right here and right now, in the midst of all of this chaos, he calls us to take up our cross and follow him. He calls us to die to our former way of life of sin and live a new life based on the teachings of the gospel. He calls us to put our love for God and neighbor above our attachment to things of this world, to be zealous in our proclamation of the gospel, to build up the kingdom of God and to create a culture of life. With St. Paul, we should be able to say, I have been crucified with Christ, yet I live no longer, but Christ lives in me. And so far as I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who has loved me and given himself up for me. You see, my friends, we should continually give thanks to him who gave his life to make full payment for the immeasurable debt we owe to God and opened up for us the gates of paradise. Today, my dear friends, we have the opportunity to thank Jesus for his love, his suffering for us so as to free us from our sins. I will lift high the cross in a few moments. And I will chant, this is the wood of the cross on which hung the Savior of the world. And I know, my brothers and sisters, I will be off key. That's just one more suffering for you to offer up. In a few moments, we will come to the cross in humble adoration and reflection. We'll show a sign of reverence, however that may be in your homes this day. And we will remember the astonishing love of God for us. And perhaps we will be inspired to make the sentiments of this prayer our own. Father, I abandon myself into your hands. Do with me what you will. Whatever you may do, I thank you. I am ready for all. I accept all. Let only your will be done in me and in all your creatures. I wish no more than this, O Lord. Into your hands I commend my soul. I offer it to you with all the love of my heart. For I love you, Lord, and so need to give myself to you, to surrender myself into your hands without reserve and with boundless confidence, for you are my Father. Amen. My brothers and sisters, without the crucifixion, there is no resurrection. Without the death, there is no new life. As the earthly Jesus gasped the final words, "It is finished." An old world of godliness ends, and the new age of Christ the King dawns, and the kingdom of heaven once again becomes our home, today, tomorrow, and for all eternity. That's why this Friday is a good Friday. Christ loves to the end. And in the end, my friends, he triumphs.
For the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God, the Father Almighty. Let us kneel.
Almighty ever-living God, who in Christ revealed your glory to all the nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church spread throughout the world may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church, to govern the holy people of God. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people, governed by you their Maker, may grow in merit by reason of their faith, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for our Bishop Gregory Amon, for all bishops, priests, and deacons of the Church, and for the whole of the faithful people. Let us kneel. let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace they may serve you faithfully, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for catechumens, that our God and Lord may open wide the ears of their inmost hearts and unload the gates of his mercy, that having received forgiveness of all their sins through the waters of rebirth, they too may be one with Christ Jesus our Lord. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, who make your church ever fruitful with new offspring, increase the faith and understanding of our catechumens, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for all our brothers and sisters who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord may be pleased as they live the truth to gather them together and keep them in his one church. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your church, of your Son, at those whom one baptism has consecrated, may be joined together by integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for the Jewish people, to whom the Lord our God spoke first, that he may grant them to advance in love of his name and in faithfulness to his covenant. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, who bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, grant that those who do not confess Christ, that by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right with sincerity of heart, they may find a way to God Himself. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, who created all people to seek you, always by desiring you and finding you come to rest, grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love and the witness of the good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you the one true God and Father of our human race, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those in public office, that our God and Lord may direct their minds and hearts according to His will, for the true peace and freedom of all. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, in those in whose hands lies every human heart and the rights of all people, look with favor, we pray, on those who govern with authority over us and throughout the whole world, the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace, and freedom of religion may through your gift be made secure. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Father Almighty, that He may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, granting to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, and salvation to the dying. Let us kneel.
Almighty, ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out to you in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice because in their hour of need your mercy was at hand, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray, dearly beloved, for a swift end to the coronavirus pandemic that afflicts our world, that our God and Father will heal the sick, strengthen those who care for them, and help us all to persevere in faith. Let us kneel.
Almighty and merciful God, source of all healing, health, and life, look with compassion on our world, brought low by disease. Protect us in the midst of the grave challenges that assail us, and in your fatherly providence grant recovery to the stricken, strength to those who care for them, and success to those working to eradicate this scourge through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Behold the wood of the cross on which hung the salvation of the world.
Come, let us adore.
Behold the wood of the cross on which hung the salvation of the world.
Come, let us adore.
Behold the wood of the cross on which hung the salvation of the world.
Come, let us adore.
The cross was an instrument of torture and suffering. It is evidence of our guilt. Yet the church sees the cross as the sign of victory. The cross brings forgiveness and mercy through the humility and obedience of Jesus. The cross represents not only Good Friday, but also Easter Sunday. Everyone is invited to now kneel and reverence the cross. The final part of today's liturgy is Holy Communion. Christ died on the cross and rose for our salvation. His death and resurrection are one great Paschal mystery. We now prepare to receive the Eucharist. In this sacred sacrament of his glorified body and blood, Jesus gives us the strength to die to our own selfishness and to rise to share his victory over sin.
At the Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, and by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
My Lord, were you there when they crucified my Lord? Oh, sometimes it causes me
brothers and sisters, I invite you now to please kneel as we make our act of spiritual communion. Please repeat after me. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most blessed sacrament. I love you above all things and desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you.
Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Oh, 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 sometimes it causes me to tremble. Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Were you
my brothers and sisters, as we go through this prolonged Good Friday, this time of death and chaos, uncertainty, fear, sickness, let us always put our hope in Jesus. Let us always cling to the cross of Christ, for from the cross comes our salvation. And so on this Good Friday, I invite you through your prayer and your fasting, through your acts of charity and kindness, to unite with the cross of Jesus. Nail all of your fear, all of the uncertainty, everything that weighs heavy on your heart, nail it to the cross. Because, my brothers and sisters, we have the blessed assurance that with every Good Friday, there will be and Easter Sunday. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Bow down for the blessing. May abundant blessing, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people, who have honored the death of your Son in hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Pace Domine, pace populo tuo. Ne in aeternum irascaris nobis. Have mercy on me, O God, in your goodness. In your abundant compassion, blot out my offense. Wash all my guilt, from my sin cleanse me. Pace Domine, pace populo tuo, ne in aeternum irascaris nobis.